So my name is Tatiana Perez-Oh, and I'm a chaplain at Island Health Orlando, the big hospital over there close to downtown. I've been there for a little over 10 years now, and I have a few different units that I cover, but throughout my 10 years, I've always covered the mother baby units. So labor delivery, the perinatal, high risk unit, and all the other infant. And throughout the years, I've developed a real passion for those areas. Of course, it's wonderful to see moms with babies. You know, we do a lot of baby blessings with new babies, and it's always fun. And a lot of people assume that, oh, you work in labor and delivery, or wow, that's like the happiest place in the hospital, right? Well, it can be, but sometimes it can be, in my opinion, sad. And so I've had the honor and privilege of walking with many families who have lost babies throughout the years. In fact, I've attended more babies than I have any other kind of death in the hospital, and have developed a real passion for this area. So I just wanted to share with you all a few thoughts, some things that I have learned on the journey, walking through grief and loss, and just how important it is to remember our babies. So I titled this talk, Embracing the One Who Lives in Your Heart. As we know, our loved ones never die because that love continues on in that sense. We never forget our little ones that have passed away. And as I was thinking about it, I remembered something that happened. It's been a few years now. I think I have two kids. My youngest is 5 and my oldest is 7. And I think my youngest was probably still in diapers in a year and a half, 2 years then. And we had received a lot of hand-me-down stuff, which I love. But there was this one Mickey Mouse about yay tall that we'd gotten as a hand-me-down. And it needed batteries, and for a while I didn't get around to getting batteries. But one day, finally, I got batteries, and I'm like, okay, let's get this Mickey Mouse going, right? And so I changed the batteries and then taught the kids how to press the button to get him going. This is one of those Mickey Mouses that, you know, would walk and talk and dance and kind of get them to do some little games. And when my kids heard this Mickey Mouse just come to life, they just started squealing, okay? Like top of your lungs. You know, I had to do this. I mean, they were just so excited and dancing around and running around the house and squealing, and of course, the Mickey, and I mean, they just love this thing. I couldn't believe it. I was so amazed. And at first, when I heard them squealing, you know, a minute passed, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, I'm like, oh my word, they're not stopping. What are the neighbors going to think? You know, what if somebody passes by and hears something crazy going on? And we live in a townhouse, and I'm like, oh my goodness, wait, no. Okay, there's nobody actually there right now, I think, so we're good. And then it just hit me, like, you know what? Just let them squeal and scream and have all the fun that they want. Who cares what the neighbors think? So when I just made that decision, I was able to simply enjoy listening to my kids screaming and glee and joy, and it was just beautiful. And then as I was listening and enjoying that, all of a sudden, this voice just spoke to my heart. I believe it was God, and just asked me, Tati, when was the last time that you allowed yourself to scream with joy, to just express your joy unabashedly and just with all of your heart and just scream like that and enjoy those little moments in life? And as I thought about it, I'm like, oh my goodness, I can't remember. I really could not remember the last time that I was able to just not only experience the height, those heights of joy, but allow myself to express them. And a moment later, as I thought of that, once again that voice asked a question. Tati, when was the last time that you allowed yourself to cry and feel the grief and pain that you need to feel? That sometimes those tears, you know, course, I remembered how my kids had no problem crying at the top of their lungs and just letting me know when they were sad or unhappy or, you know, mad. And it just reminded me of the wisdom, you know, just to be like little children and I'll return to the kingdom of heaven. What a beautiful lesson I felt that I was learning from my kids. And as I thought of that, it made me think that perhaps living life to the fullest is not so much about having fun experiences and traveling and having fun and, you know, good stuff, you know. Maybe living life to the fullest is more about embracing all that life has to show and all the experiences that we can have. The heights of joy and the depths of sadness. Maybe if I could live my life with my heart open and willing to embrace it all, I could truly be living life to the fullest. I love this, there's this quote that I found. This is by Anna White, and she said, "It is the capacity to feel consuming grief and pain and despair that also allows me to embrace love and joy and beauty with my whole heart. I must let it all in." The place that I feel I have witnessed in one setting, at one time, the most acutely, right, that experience of seeing the heights of joy and the depths of sorrow has actually been those moments when I've been able to be with parents, where they're able to give birth and then see those tears of joy as they welcome their baby and they're like ooing and aahing over their beautiful little boy or girl, and at the same time see the mixture of tears of grief because they know they're not going to be able to take their baby home with them. I've always been in awe of the incredible complexity and just mixture of these emotions that surround us when we're saying hello to our child. Honestly, I feel like I'm walking on holy ground. There was this one couple that I had the privilege of being there with them when she delivered her baby, you know, preterm, of course, you know, too early to survive out of her womb. And after she delivered, she asked the nurse, can I hold my baby? And so the nurse grabbed the baby and brought him over. And I, you know, I saw her as she just was like, wow, I'm gonna just cry. And the husband was sitting by her, and at first he was actually hesitant to see the baby. And you know, it's understandable. A lot of parents don't know what to make of, especially a preterm small baby. So at first he hesitated, but you know, he took a few moments for himself, took a deep breath, and he's like, okay. And then he got really loved. Oh, and the tears of joy. And he was like oohing and aahing along with his wife over this beautiful little boy that she was holding. Then, after a few minutes, I heard the wife say, to her husband, she's like, I wanted so bad to give you a son. I'm so sorry. I wanted to give you a son so bad. I'm so sorry. And he's like, honey, don't say that. What are you talking about? You gave me a son. Look at him. He's beautiful. Look at him. He's so, so beautiful. And it was just precious to see that interaction and to watch them as they embraced that moment of joy, wooing and aahing over their baby, and at the same time, allowing themselves to grieve, because they knew that they were going to miss their son. And in this process, I've learned that it's okay for us to be able to experience and embrace both the joys and the sorrows, the highs and the lows, the ups and the downs of life. Brene Brown once said, she's awesome. So this is another quote, this is from her. She said, "To love someone fiercely, to believe in something with your whole heart, celebrate a fleeting moment in time, to fully engage in a life that doesn't come with guarantees. These are risks that involve vulnerability and often pain. But I'm learning that recognizing and learning, leaning into the discomfort of vulnerability, teaches us how to live with joy, gratitude, and grace. So the first thing I want to leave with you and encourage you to do is to embrace both the joys and the sorrows that might be as part of living life to the fullest and the richness of experience that we have there. The second thing I want to leave with you is this. Life doesn't always make yet, even in the midst of those moments where I've heard so many parents asking why and saying, I don't understand, I find myself in awe because of the richness of me that these lives have. And so today I want to encourage you to embrace, maybe not so much knowing all the whys, right? All the making sense of things, but embrace the meaning of the life of your baby and the meaning of experiences that you have. I believe that we can learn, and some of the best experiences I've seen in parents who've lost babies has been when parents going through the season of loss have embraced making meaning out of the life of their baby, and they do something in honor of their baby. I've heard it said that, of course we never forget our baby, but I've heard it said that when parents lose their child, just because they lose their child doesn't mean that they lose the need to parent their child. That need still actually exists. And a lot of times when we have our children, there is an instinct, right, in parents to protect their child. But when a baby dies, there's an instinct to protect that memory. And I believe one of the best ways that we can do that is by honoring our child. And I think this is one of the things that we're doing today, is honoring this story, honoring how they have touched our lives. And that's why I brought here just an example. I've been so blessed and touched by so many parents who wanted to do something in honor of their baby. And this is an example of this one mom that for many years, she prepared these memory boxes that we gave after her little girl had died, Viviana. And she says that what inspired her to the memory box was the fact that when she went home, one of the most painful things was going home with empty arms. So she wanted to give something for parents to carry with them in honor of their baby. And to this day, we do our best in our mother baby units to give a memory box for parents to take home with them. And so I just have a few things in here too. We have organizations where they do beautiful angel gowns out of old wedding gowns, and little cribs, and of course, just beautiful things that to put into the memory boxes. This has been such a beautiful example of how many families have found meaning. But at the same time, you know, we don't always have to do something big in order to honor the life of our child. Sometimes we can find meaning in being intentional about learning the life lessons that our child has to teach us. I love this book. I recommend it by Lindsay Dennis, and she actually is from here, from Florida. And I got to meet her and her husband. They lost two girls. One of them was delivered at my hospital, and I was witness to some of that. And in the aftermath, you know, her grief loss, she wrote this book. And very candidly, really talk about her faith journey with God, and as she dealt with her grief. And at the very end, she was, you know, reflecting on, you know, how she wished that her two girls would be alive. You know, she wished things were different. And at the same time, she was reflecting on what she had learned in her journey, and, you know, wondering, would I change things, would I not? You know, I still want them to be alive. And, but then at one point, she writes in her journal to God, and she says, I would not trade my story for another, for in doing so, I would lose so much. Perhaps it would seem I have already lost so much, but whatever things were gained to me, those things I have counted as lost for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of mine, Christ Jesus, my Lord. That's from Philippians 3. This I know, that today I love you more than I did 3 years ago. But more than that, today your greatness, your glory, your profound worthiness of my life is both more mystery and more clear at the same time. Your holiness has been revealed to me in ways I never knew. Your greatness at the cross is clear because the reality of the tomb being empty is more profound. Life has won, death is defeated, and you, Lord, have become my greatest hope. Yes, yes to your ways, for your ways are good and right, and even in death, your ways lead to life. And I just love how deeply she has been able to experience God through her grief journey. So there's so much meaning to be had in our journeys, and I just want to encourage you today to embrace that. And there's just one more thing I want to do. In the midst of this all, I just want you to remember to be kind to yourself. Be kind. It is very normal for us to have our ups and downs, our good days and our bad days, to be crabby one moment and then be happy the next, you know. It is very normal to want to put the finger at us, at ourselves. And I just want to remind you to be good to yourself. Sheryl Sandberg wrote a book called Option B, Facing Adversity, Building Resilience, and Finding Joy. She wrote this after she suddenly lost her husband to a heart attack. One of her chapters is titled Self-Compassion. And she has some beautiful things to say about self-compassion. And one of the things is, self-compassion comes from recognizing that our imperfections are part of being human. Those who can tap into it recover from hardships faster. And then she goes to talk about a few studies that were done about people who come with different difficulties. And they noticed that what they had in common, the people who were able to just kind of get out of that being stuck, is that they